Hi everyone, this is Sujita. Welcome to the FocusNet JRF English Literature channel. Today we are going to see some writers from Anglo-Norman literature. So these are the writers we are going to see today: William Langland, John Mandeville, John Wycliffe, Thomas Occleve, and John Lydgate. So let's go to the first writer, William Langland. So his timeline is from 1332 to 1386. So William Langland is poor, but he's so religious, he's so devoted to his religion. His work is Piers the Plowman. It is dream allegorical in nature. The beginning line of the poem is, "The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord." So this is written in West Midland dialect. So in this poem, he's talking about life, capital sins, dangers of materialism and spiritual growth. He satirizes the corrupted church, the corrupted clergyman. And he's also talking about the secular authority and depicts the miseries and sufferings of the needy people. And he is also upholding the dignity and value of the labor. There are two parts in the poem. The first part is Vision of Piers. In this part, Piet lies down on a Malvern Hills on a morning and he is having a dream in which the Piers appears. And the second part, it is also a series of vision in which seven deadly sins appears. So pride, luxury, envy, wrath, avarice, gluttony and sloth, these are the seven deadly sins. And all these are allegorically figured. Okay, the poem, because he wants to depict to the people that the clergy is corrupted, the church is corrupted, all those things, and that's why he's allegorically figuring everything. He can't tell it directly, so he's allegorically depicting all those things. So this is the plot of the poem. The poem begins in Malvern Hills, where the poet is asleep. So he's having a vision. Okay, in the vision, he sees a tower which is set upon a hill, and there is also a fortress which is lying deep in the valley. So tower represents heaven and the fortress represent hell. So in between these two places, you can see so many people walking here and there. So Piers, he is a virtuous plowman who plows his half acre land. He meets three people while he was plowing. The first one is Duval, represent consciousness. Dubit, represent grace. And Do Best, represent charity. So Piers, in the next scene, he is visited by seven deadly sins while he was plowing. But he refuses to. Those seven deadly sins were trying to talk to him, were trying to distract him from what he was doing. But he refuses to entertain them and he continues to do his work. Through this, he is preaching us how hard work leads to salvation. So whatever work we do, if we have planned to do something for an hour, if we have planned to study for an hour, we have to be very consistent with that. We should not be distracted by our phones or any other medias or any other things. So we should be so devoted to what we are doing in that particular hour. So if we work hard like that, it will definitely lead to success. So in the end, the Easter bell rings and the poet wakes up listening to that. So that's how the poem ends. So this is the only poem we have for William Langland. So we have to know about Piers the Plowman and what does it says about and what is it about. All those things we need to know. Let's go to the next writer. John Mandeville, 1300 to 1371. He is an explorer actually. So he explored many countries. And this is the only work of John Mandeville, The Travels of Sir John Mandeville. Okay, so it's a travel memoir. So, you know, John Mandeville, he had explored many countries, and he thought, why not we write our experience in a book? And that's how he wrote The Travel of Sir John Mandeville. Okay, so even Christopher Columbus and Marco Polo, these two people are also legendary voyages. Okay, so these two people have inspired and influenced by John Mandeville's works. Okay, so this is all about John Mandeville. You need to know, no need to go in depth. Okay, so let's go to the next writer, John Wycliffe. So he is an English philosopher. John Wycliffe is an English philosopher, theologian, biblical translator. He's a reformer and he's also a priest. Being a priest, you know, he sees the Catholic Church to be corrupted. And so he is rebelling against the church. And some people are even supporting him. This group of John Wycliffe is called as Lollards. The name Lollard was not picked by them. It was given to them by their oppositors in a mocking way. Lollard is a mocking word. So what is Lollard movement? What did they do? So John Wycliffe is considered to be the leader of Lollards, and it is a medieval reform movement based on the writings and teachings of John Wycliffe. Lollards have profound disagreement with the Catholic Church because it is so much corrupted. So what are their demands? They demanded social reform. That is all they need, a social reform. So he is also telling that Bible should be available in the vernacular language. So, you know, Bible was available only in Latin language, and the people, the common people who doesn't know the Latin language couldn't understand what is in the Bible. The clergyman who has to do that work is not doing that work properly. So the people is unaware of the verses in the Bible. So Wycliffe and his followers are requesting that the Bible should be translated in the vernacular language. And they are also telling that Pope had no part to play in worldly affairs. Even Pope is corrupt at that time. So Lollards, what they did, they preached English language to the common people and implant the need for reformation. They need reformation. Everything is corrupted. Even the religious thing is corrupted. And so they want reformation, and they are implanting it to the common people. They're making them understand what is happening around them. Okay. And that's why he is called as the morning star of the Reformation, that is twinkling so bright. And he is the priest who go against corruption and heresy. Wycliffe also translated a Bible. So he translated the Latin Vulgate Bible into English. He did not translate the Bible from the original version, which is written in Hebrew. But he translated the Latin Vulgate Bible into English in 1382. So this is all about John Wycliffe. So he has written a Bible which is translated from Latin to English in 1382. This is very, very important. So this is what you need to know about John Wycliffe. Okay, let's go to the next writer. Thomas Occleve. 1368 to 1426. He is an English poet and a clerk. So this is the work you need to know. Regiment of Princes or De Regimine Principum. It is actually written for Henry V. I already told you in the history, Anglo-Norman history video, who Henry V is. So this work, Regiment of Princes, is written for Henry V. And this work is an elaborative discourse on virtues and vices. Okay, so this is all about Thomas Occleve. Let's go to the next writer, John Lydgate, 1370 to 1449. He is a monk as well as a poet. So he admires Chaucer and imitates the verse structure of Chaucer. He's so into Chaucer. He likes so much. Okay. So, you know, he even imitates the verse structure of Chaucer. Serpent of Divisions. This is his only original work. So it is a brief account on Julius Caesar. What all the terrible consequences of political and social divisions happened during that period. Work is Fall of Princes. This is originally written by Boccaccio in French. So it contained 9 books and nearly 30,000 lines. Okay. So lives and tragic death of so many historical and legendary persons has been recorded here. So you can also tell that it's an elaboration of Chaucer's Monk's Tale from the Canterbury Tales. Okay. So the next work is Reason of Sensuality. This is also translated from French. It is an allegory. And the theme of this work is chastity. The next work of John Lydgate is The Book of Troy. So this work he write it at the command of the Prince of Wales and later at the command of Henry V. So the next work, The Story of Thebes. You can tell that it is another Canterbury tale. So another version of Canterbury Tales. Okay. So the next work is The Complaint of Black Knight. This is actually modeled on Chaucer's Book of Duchess. So in the upcoming videos, we'll be seeing Chaucer's work. So The Complaint of Black Knight is just another version of Chaucer's Book of Duchess. Okay. So The Temple of Glass. This is also an imitation of Chaucer's The House of Fame. We will see other Anglo-Norman writers in the upcoming videos. Hope you have understood what I have taught you. Stay tuned with me until next video. Thank you.